Welcome. Now we're about to hit the road with the show. We're starting with the state of the polity. But just before we get to that, there's this tweet by the Minister of Transportation. Mm-hmm. And he says, the free rides on the Lagos-Ibadan standard gauge rail will begin, I think, is it today? Or is it yesterday? That's 8 hours ago. Mm-hmm. Will begin and run through till March 2020. And he's advising commuters on that route to take advantage of it. And
free
save
rides
on
for 4 months?
Yes. And save on transportation during the festive season and beyond. And it says, let's ride to the next level. That's coming from the Minister of Transportation, Mr. Rotimi
Amaechi. For 4 months?
That is the minister talking. Okay. I didn't say anything. I just read out a tweet that
yes.
came in.
Okay. I hope you all heard that. So take advantage from today.
That's part of the state of the polity. But see this, Nigeria is burdened with so many issues bordering on socioeconomic, political, and financial. On the program today, we will take a look at the state of the polity, such as the cost of governance, how far as per constituency projects have gone, social media bill, alternative to oil revenue, amongst others. So it's going to be somewhat nifty, but deep. So if we hear or say we're any here, just know that we couldn't take it all. But so to help us discuss all of this, we'll start from our Abuja studio. We have architect Ezekiel Nyaitok, who is the Director General of the Nigeria First Project. And he's smiling.
Ezekiel, what are you feeling so happy about today?
He will tell us about that in a moment. Here in Lagos, we have Oscar Onwudiwe, who's a legal practitioner. Thank you for joining us. And Tony Daniel, also a legal practitioner. Thank you for joining us, gentlemen. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're not smiling.
No, I was busy.
Ezekiel was smiling.
At Ezekiel, yes.
He was smiling.
I was admiring him.
Okay. Okay, let's start from there, since you're the only one smiling. Architect Ezekiel Nyaitok, please tell us, why are you smiling?
I like the idea that there's free ride for 4 months. I think it's good. But you see, I was born on the 1st of November, and this is the last day of November. So a lot of been going on that's good. And then part of what went on was Madam Bakwa, the Grandma General of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, who just turned 107 years, the First Lady of Local Government Administration in British Africa. And I have been so happy celebrating this woman. And it's given me so much joy the whole of this month. Apart from that, I believe that the time has come when we must realize that keeping a positive disposition is something we cannot afford the luxury of not doing. So I'm happy.
Okay, it's good that you're happy. Let's
like
come back here
further
from
the beginning of the program. Every day you wake up
give
healthy
thanks.
And strong, you need to be thankful.
Mr. Onwudiwe, the situation. Architect Ezekiel told us why he is happy.
Yeah.
In spite of all that there is,
right.
He is happy. Positive disposition.
Yeah, my answer to that is when I grow up, I'll be like him.
Please, when are you going to grow up?
I don't know yet. But whenever I grow up, I'll be like him.
Let's start out immediately and look at this cost of government. He mentioned something which is quite interesting, 4 months of free ride on the Lagos-Ibadan axis of the rail lines. Mm. That's good. And it's to get people to understand that part of transportation is fixed and it can be used, as in get used to it and then save costs and then save the pressure on the roads. But in the face of all of that, there's still the other bit about cost of governance in the country. What would you...
I have a feeling that the type of politics we run in Nigeria makes it difficult to cut down cost of governance. Number one, when Obasanjo was president, he actually set up a committee for one purpose, advise me on how we can reduce cost of governance. A bunch of very intelligent people, they came together and they looked at so many ministries and so many other departments that are practically doing the same thing and say, you know what, you could merge all of this, you could reduce staff, you could do this, that they pruned down from about 125 they pruned down to about 75, and they submitted this report. Had a handshake and thank you. And what happened? Not only did you not have implementation, before Obasanjo left office, it has moved from 125 to 150. That's the way it goes. Now, as we speak, they are close to about 300.
Department and agencies.
Oh, we're talking different things. You just form this committee, form that, and leave them on. And that's the way it goes. And they are being paid salaries. Then other times, you now people now increase ADs. You know, if you can have before, when Obasanjo was there, I don't think he had up to 100. Now you can count. It's not only in Abuja, all over the states. So at times it's like, okay, this is the only opportunity I can get every member of my family and friends into government. And who pays? Government. From what source? Oil.
Yeah, and government can ill afford it in some states. Yeah.
That is it. We are not serious. There is too much emphasis on government, government, and government.
All right, we'll take a moment and we'll come back from the break. We'll hear from Mr. Dania. How do we move forward from here? Please stay with us. Thank you for staying with us. Our conversation today, we're starting out with the state of the polity. We're looking at everything, cost of governance, constituency projects, and how we can move the nation forward. Mr. Dania, before we went on that break, Mr. Onwudie was talking about the need to grow up into some things. But we're looking at the cost of governance now. What do you think about the cost of governance, and how can we bring it down?
Yeah. When we look at the cost of governance and you look at the situation in the country, the tendency is if you are interested in Nigeria making progress, you'll be so sad. But I strongly believe, like our colleague from Abuja said, I am positive-minded that things will change. Now, I will quickly want to refer to this company, P&ID, that got $9 billion judgment against the federal government. I took time to research into that. The point, one point I will hold on to is somebody that was a chief justice of this federation, retired, engaged on consultancy basis by the government, was a counsel against the government in favor of P&ID. Other big names have been mentioned to be involved. The bane of this, they plan to sell off Nigeria. And some Nigerians who are supposed to be highly respected, we are involved. Now, having said this, I come back home. Contextually, everybody, you know, there's no person that didn't come out from a family. It will take time to reorientate Nigerians. We all came out from a family. Some families want you to get rich quick. And what is the essence of emancipating wealth? Everybody think of government. Then 419. Now, if you discourage getting, you know, stupendously rich while in government, if you discourage it, cost of governance will drop dramatically. And how do we discourage this? The people in government must be interested. No matter how much we criticize Buhari, he have other areas he has done well. But the few other areas dwarf those achievements he has made within the time he has been the president of this federation. For instance, you say you are fighting corruption. We all know corruption is the bane. Corruption contributes to about 75% of the high cost of governance in this country because there's no contract done, payments are made. When they are done, they are highly inflated. When they are done, they are half done. No way to monitor. It's only recently the populace. We may have been aware, enlightened minds have been aware, but it's now that the government is coming up with the orientation that constituency project, you have a right to monitor it. But those days, when they come up with a constituency project, you see them clapping as if those persons are using their personal money to do the little that they are doing. But if you investigate, like ICPC have started investigating now, you discover a lot of things. Now, the first step to reduce cost of governance. Because I said I have positive hope for this country because, sorry to use this language, Nigeria will develop, but it will be by mistake. Let me tell you how the mistake will come. first information bill, it was a mistake. The government did not know that they are undoing themselves when they passed that bill. The first person that was prosecuted, I mean, jailed or convicted on that first information was is a commissioner in Delta State. So, by that, let us find solution to one thing first, and that is electricity. If you find solution to electricity, the cost of buying generator, maintaining generator, comes back to the ordinary barber at the shop, come back to the market women, come back to people like us who are not in government. I know how much it costs me to run a plant in my house and in my office. So when you save that, and it will make people, you know, ordinarily, people record events now with their phones. When there is light, CCTV camera will be everywhere, and you can catch scenes, you know. To some extent, we are catching scenes. Then we shall continue.
Not crimes, scenes.
Yes. So you, when you could be scene of crime, it could be scene of something that somebody is doing secretly. We out of the leakage of the central bank governor planning with some other governor to steal Nigerian money. Nothing was done. Then why I said we will continue to criticize Buhari is that something must be done. When we talk about when corrupt practices are exposed one way or the other, we don't hear nothing about it. There is no sacred cow. Something must be done. So the punitive measure must be done. Reorientation of the family. Some family will deliberately take their children to go and learn how to do 409. Some family will do everything for their children to go into governance. You know, I am a high chief. My title is Okoye Ogbe means the man that brought peace and unity. Let me tell you something. When we're talking about bringing peace and unity in the community, because of the war, some parents were sending their children to secret court. Go and learn how to shoot. So that I said that war will not end. So parents, family reorientation must come in. Every person in government came out from the family. You can tell to some extent the pressure that the first lady is going through. But when you hear her, I read about what she said today, complaining about the decadence in governance. You see, she came from a family. Buhari himself came from a family. The governors and the rest came from a family. I'm talking about governor. The legacies provided, we are providing for the governors are extremely unnecessary. 400% of their income to be given to them as loan, car allowances. The ex-governors that spent just 8 years are highly...
Some four.
And you say they are retired. Retired what? We've gotten... And another thing is, this administration is becoming very negatively popular for disobedience of court order. That is one thing I have against Buhari. Otherwise, some areas I commend him. Talking about the closure of the border, for instance, the advantages are more, but we could have improved on the advantages if we took our time to check what it will cost legitimate businessmen.
Okay.
Who will be prevented from using the border.
Okay. Let's bring in Architect Nyeitok. Architect Nyeitok, Mr. Dania has spoken strongly about certain things happening in the country. But let's look at a bit on the laws as they are. The Revenue Allocation Commission, the act that set it up, gives it the power to determine how much public servants, public office holders would be paid. And unless, and I stand to be corrected here, so far the information I have is that governors get a certain amount of money annually, which is less than 12 million as salary. That includes basic, which is about less than 3 million basic, and then the allowances. 400% of their basic, about 400% of that is given to them as car loans for cars and maintenance. They are allowed no limit in terms of travel allowances, whether local or international. But it appears they still go. He talked about the largesse that they get while they are in office is too much. And then we have some collecting pensions and then going to the Senate to still collect some of that on. That also adds to the cost of governance. Even the political office holders who get paid certain severances and all of that. But there's an appeal court judgment that said it's illegal. Would that, if that is looked at, if the laws are implemented as they are, would we not cut down the cost of governance?
Thanks for the question. But I wonder why we find it difficult to think. I had parents who were not really high. My mother, for instance, dropped out in primary 3, and she was the one that sent me through school. And I think one of the things I owe her is to be able to use my head to think. Now, what is so difficult for us to understand what government is, the essence of government? What is it that is so difficult for us to know who a governor is and the role he's expected to play? What's so difficult for us to see what the Constitution says, chapter 2, section 14, subsection 2b, that says that the security and the welfare of the people shall be the primary purpose of government? What's so difficult about that? Let's come back home. What is government? It's an aggregation of the wealth of the people entrusted to administrators to administer on the behalf of the generality of the people. I gave this example before. In a place like Akwa Ibom State, in the last 2019 budget, if you took the budget and divided by the population, every single person in Akwa Ibom State was entitled to almost 130,000 naira per annum. Who am I referring to? I'm referring to that nobody, Mr. Odofia, who has a wife and has 8 children, making him 10. That man is entitled to 1.3 million for the year. And at the end of the year, the only thing that that man has seen as government is a ballot box that came into his constituency. Nothing more than that. Yet, the governors, who are custodians of the commonwealth of the people, on the behalf of the generality of the people, are living like lords, like kings, and we don't see anything wrong with that. They are not accountable to the people. While they are in office, even the investments they do not take investment from others or opposition because they are indirectly part of the investment. Go check it out. Most of the so-called industries, organizations, go check out the ownership structure. You realize that a good number of them have surrogates of the governors directly or indirectly fused into these things. And when they leave the office, they have the audacity, the effrontery, the animal boldness to say they should be paid more. Let me tell you this. I'll tell you this for a fact. Time is going to come, and time is coming, when these issues shall be revisited. That's why we run governance of abracadabra. Nothing is open. Everything is secret. We want to run a certain company. We don't want to show what the ownership structure of that company is. We want to do an industry. We don't know whether government is funding that industry or a private initiative. And if it is a PPP, private-public partnership, we want to know the share stakes of each of the people involved. The time has come when we, the elite, must stand up and demand transparency, accountability. The time has come when we must only respect governors and not worship them. That time has come. It is when the citizens are enlightened. And I want to thank you for what you are doing today so that we are not just, doing analysis. When the citizens are enlightened to know their right, then there's going to be a silent, let me use that controversial word, revolution, which is not going to be, it's a revolution based on knowledge and enlightenment and demand of right as right, okay? We're not talking of wars or fights. No, the best revolution you can have is throwing light into the minds of the generality of the people and let them see. I'll end on this note. A little child was being taken care of by a boy, another man. And he said, Richard, get me this. Richard, go and do this. Until one day, when he said, Richard, the boy turned and looked at him and said, Prince Richard. In which case, that boy has come to know that he's a prince. From that day, the custodian becomes careful, knowing that Richard knows he's a prince. Governors have taken for granted that we think that
We are just their subject, and that the resources of state are their personal estate for them to administer according to their whims and caprices. Time is now when we are starting to wake up Nigerians that these guys are your boys. Your governor is your boy. He's your employee. You pay his salary. So he's accountable to you. Things are going to change. Trust me. Is your pension or no pension? To start with, the concept of pension is a concept of reward of a man who has put in all his life and has come to a point where he's probably no longer able to continue, which is retirement, and government now starts to take care of him in appreciation of the services he has put in all through the years. And yet a young man retires as a governor, less than 50 or 60, takes up a position as a senator, and you pay him pension, and that guy is so morally depraved that he cannot even say for himself that this is wrong.
Thanks. Okay. Thanks. Oscar, we're talking about costs of governance, and we have reached a position now where Nigeria can ill afford its expenses. So it is now looking for money, whichever way it can.
Yeah.
And that has resulted in increase in taxes. Mm-hmm. Now, I find, or I see, that many Nigerians are reluctant to pay taxes. And the bulk of this reluctance arises from the fact that they do not trust government. So increasing the taxes, do you see that solving our problem in any way? When most people who are supposed to pay taxes do not pay,
yeah.
And those who are paying look for any which way to make sure that they pay as little as possible.
Well, I think you answered it. You're really not asking a question.
Oh, I'm not?
Oh, yes. You answered it. You said that people do not pay because they don't trust. There is trust deficit. It's been on. It is worse now. And it will continue to improve until you have a government that clearly shows sincerity of purpose. You see, for a tax, for you to pay tax, you must be earning. How much job has this government created? They've killed more businesses than they have made. The major business today is government. So tell me, is it the same people who, in government, if you're making money, they are invisibles? You don't see the money that is being made. So it's not recorded. How do you tax it? You can't. The man's salary is 700,000. That's what is recorded, so you tax him on 700,000. You don't tax on allowances. Then he has allowance, travel allowance of 3 million. He has this, he has that in millions. How do you tax it? So the same government that wants to tax that man, me, for instance, will not tax themselves because they also know how to doctor the books. So this is the problem. And now they're doing something that is totally illegal. They could actually go into somebody's account, see the money there. They don't know whether you're owing, whether you have an arrangement with your suppliers abroad and you accumulate money and send back to them because you're getting goods on credit. And they go in there and say, oh, we've seen some millions there. They just deduct tax. It's illegal. They have no right to do it. No bank should allow them to do it, but they're doing it. And they tell you, we have to increase taxes. Then we have to borrow. The truth is, how well are you managing this? The day we have a government that will say the first thing we want to do is to build back confidence in Nigerians that we are here to work, not here to chop, you see a difference. Nigerians are the easiest people to govern. The easiest people to govern. They just want to see things going right, and they will respond. But it's unfortunate. You know, when Ezekiel was talking, he mentioned why, what is difficult about people understanding this about the Constitution. I wanted to give him a quick answer. Culture. All the problems we're having, one thing we've never done is to go down and do a proper research into our culture and what makes us do what we do.
Okay, Mr. Mudwe, we'll come back and begin from that point about the culture. Please stay with us.
You don't wait for life. You go to meet life. It's not about how many chances you get. It's what you do with what you've got. Cup after cup. Morning after morning. Start strong. Finish strong. It all starts with a Nescafé.
Greetings from Mega Praises Limited.
President Buhari unveils a document that is believed to hold the key to unlocking the nation's fortune in digital economy.
In assisting the president to unveil the national digital economy strategy.
At the forefront of driving the process is the Minister of Communications and Digital Economy.
How can we deploy communications and support our economy individually and collectively? There are 8 areas that we need each and every stakeholder to give us the necessary support and work together so that by the end of 2023, we will be proud to say that Nigeria is a digitalized country. These areas, in summary, starting number 1 is developmental regulation.
The thinking is that with remarkable contributions to the country's GDP so far, the sector could be a huge employer that adds up to ₦1 trillion to the country's purse annually. For 2 days, stakeholders here will brainstorm on how best to proceed. Hopefully, they will resolve some of the obstacles to growth. The keynote speaker acknowledges some of them, including absence of a proper framework.
Our national ICT development strategy is not clear. As Nigerians in the industry, we recognize that our national development agenda cannot be based on the profit-making agenda of businesses or simply consumption of global technology. We need our government to define and pursue a specific development agenda.
President Muhammadu Buhari says the sector holds a lot of promise and directs all ministries, departments and agencies to key in.
And all ministries, departments and agencies are expected to comply with these policies. I have therefore directed the Federal Ministry of Communications and Digital Economy to develop training and sensitization programs that will be rolled out across all key MDAs with immediate effect.
2 young Nigerians who excelled in global competitions in artificial intelligence were honored with federal government providing funds for startups. It's the 12th edition of the eNigeria Conference, an event that serves as platform for ICT awareness and creation, as well as setting goals for best practices. From Abuja, Ibrahim Adra, Channels Television News.
Thank you for staying with us. Festus Akinbuewa said the obscene earnings of many of our political leaders in and out of office as exposed recently in Adamawa State shows our political space is filled with political mob and autocrats who are only interested in non-transparent power. Yusuf Adebanjo, talking about the free transport, says, please prevail on the transport minister to initiate as quickly as possible online ticketing services for our rail transport. train commuters go through hell due to activities of touts. The minister should please act. Online ticketing service for train. So anyway, you were talking about culture.
Yeah.
And how that has influenced the situation as it is. And is that why we're, it seems the country's going around in a circle?
Exactly. This is the reason. See, as far as I can remember, from 1912 up until when the British left, every 3 years, they do analysis of the various tribes and they document it. They're there in the archives in England. From 1912, they'll tell you, oh, the Igbos of the East, this is their tendencies. The Yorubas, this is their tendencies. Then, because if you don't understand a people, and you bring one law from somewhere, say it works very well in Singapore, it works very well here, why shouldn't it work for you here? You're going to have a problem. It's the same thing with even religion. Your culture affects your spirituality. We don't seem to want to remember and talk about it. In this country, there are people that democracy naturally does not flow with them, with their culture. But now, oh, democracy is what the whole world is doing, and you put it on them. So what do you have? They'll practice their own homegrown, that's the word, homegrown democracy, an imperial president, an imperial governor, imperial commissioners, and then you want to complain about corruption. For heaven's sake, they wouldn't even understand what you're saying. Even the people are looking up to them, oh, since you're in that position, oh, yes, then it's time. Everybody is hustling for one thing. How can I have audience with this man? He may be in a good mood and dash me some, meaning he owns it. Let me give you an example. When we started in 1960, even before 1960, when Sir Ahmadu Bello was the governor of, no, the premier of Northern Nigeria, the story is that he had no bank account anywhere. Nowhere. The money of Northern Nigeria was his money. That was his account. He didn't have any other account. And it is understood by that culture. And no complaints. Nothing. So we don't understand it. And then we get confused, particularly a lot of us from Southern Nigeria who probably recognize democracy and we're in tune with democracy because we have a culture that is in tune with democracy. We must begin to discuss this culture and then let people fit it. That's why we're saying if you restructure Nigeria, allow people to develop at their own pace. So that if your culture says this is the way it is, go ahead. One day when you begin to see that the other people are making better progress, maybe you begin to adapt, maybe you begin to change. But for as long as it is this forced thing, without taking care. I give you an example. When some friends were discussing the hate speech bill, and what did I say? I said, listen, if Sabi Abdullahi was from Eastern region and he moved, he proposed that bill, he will never come home. He will not, if he comes, he will be hiding. They'll beat him up. Those are the people who understand. They'll say, what no, is that what we sent you there to do? But he could go home and be comfortable. Culture. He's not a bad man. He doesn't mean harm. But he's coming from a totally different orientation. If you remember, 1984, we had the man that is now here who came and believed, look, Nigeria is indisciplined and we can solve it with force. Flog people into line, beat them up. Then he was thrown out. Babangida came in, was better advised. And what did he say? He says, you know what? I'll set up an orientation agency. So that, because there's one thing we keep forgetting. The most important imperative in human development is the mindset factor. How do you think? How do you reason? And what is your mindset? And Babangida felt this is the best thing to do. If we work on the mindset of the people, we can bring them to the level where you don't need to tell them to be disciplined. They will see the
advantage. But let me quickly ask you this. How do you weigh culture against mindset?
Oh, now, is the
can mindset be swayed and can culture be moved by mindset?
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you this. First, it starts with the culture. Culture is the way you do things, the way you've been taught to do things. And when you do it over a period, it becomes your mindset. That's as simple as that. So, and we don't seem to remember, because we're not being scientific about dealing with each other. Your culture dictates your attitude. And your attitude will predict your altitude. That's how it starts. We are not working on it. We are not working on it. And we can't work on it nationally. It's wrong. This National Orientation Agency should be studying the various people and know the messages to give to them and bring them out. I'll give you an example. Papawolo, when he was asked in 1978, what do you have for Northern Nigeria if you become president? He said, I have three things. Education, education, education. If you remember, it was Lord Lugard who made sure that there would be no education in the North. Lord Lugard, that was the first thing. To him, education was not good for the black man. It made him less fertile and susceptible to lung cancer. Lord Lugard, 1912. Now, these are the people. And from that time, a new set of leaders took over from the British and sustained it. And that's why you can have 12 million people out of school. And it is accepted.
Mr. Dania,
culture.
We've looked at revenue, taxation in a way, without it necessarily saying, but let's look at this thing about freedom of speech, the social media bill, the hate speech bill and all of that. You being a lawyer and the constitution that guarantees freedom of speech and all that, what do you think?
I will come to that, but let me first of all take from
There's no time, we really have
Culture is dynamic, it's not static. And the essence of education and civilization is to improve on culture. Before now, we have different method of using, bringing justice. It's more of self-help. It's more what we now call jungle justice, used to be the culture in some areas, where you do something wrong, and some still try to do it, even in this present civilization. Those days, Zamfara, when he said, you must comply with Sharia law, and Sharia law says, culture will definitely improve with time. So having said that, the hate speech thing, honestly, I personally, I don't see anything wrong in trying to regulate what you say and how you say it. My colleagues, Falana and Co, have said, we have slander, we have libel, which is pre-existing. We also have a lot of offenses covered by the criminal code, but we have special laws made for special offenses, like the Miscellaneous Offenses Act, like the Advanced Fee Fraud. Advanced Fee Fraud is in criminal code. The only fear, like he rightly said, is lack of trust for our leader. People are already feeling this will be negatively exploited to deal with passive political enemies. Otherwise, we've seen a lot of things in the social media. And what happened at the end? Sorry. If you post something in the social media and people react in such a way and cause death, we already have murder. I spoke against the former director of DSS when he sent 7 operatives to Arepo and they were killed by vandals. I said he should be taken for murder because it is the cause of their death. Because shortly before that, they have killed some policemen. I expect the DSS to relate with the policemen, share intelligence, and take a more a better approach. But he sent 7 operatives and they were killed. I'm aware they have arrested the killers, the suspects, and they are trying them. So what I'm saying is this. If we don't regulate it, we'll continue to have a lot of issues. Regulating it, I agree that death sentence should be removed. But if you post something and a death occurs by reaction, you should be arrested for the existing law, murder. But regulating it does not stop slander and defamation action. What it does is you don't deliberately come and post a falsehood with the intention of demeaning somebody. If we detach ourselves from that lack of trust, I'm very sure people will see the objectives in regulating information. Having said that, please, I will still come back to this. Reducing the cost of governance. I give you an example, please. 10 seconds. I give you an example. When the president came up with TSI, TSA. We were all commending him. But we all read when the government came up to say that billions were paid as COTs and other charges. I was utterly disappointed that the same president that set up TSA with the intention of combating corruption kept quiet. Me, my small business, there is a limit I withdraw money to in my account. I pay zero TOT. If I go beyond that, I pay for the cost of going below that amount. If I can do that, what government, we have accountant, we have professional, you mean they cannot think that way? So you give reason, sorry I'm raising my voice, I'm just so, you know, concerned about the happenings in Nigeria. My colleague who is older has told me to calm down, but you see, yeah, you can help it, you know? Yeah. Now, when you see that kind of thing, how do you react? Okay. This, you know, when you relate with every society, you know that this corruption and compromises are almost in everywhere, Paul,
okay,
anywhere.
Okay, that's okay. We really have to move fast at this point because we're fast running out of time. Ezekiel, let's look at the border closure. What effect is this having on our polity?
We must realize that we may need to take difficult situations sometimes to arrive at a predetermined end. I am one of those 100% in agreement with Mr. President. I know that some people had taking initiative to do certain business, which is going to be transborder and all those things, and they are affected. Unfortunately, I wish we could find a way of creating a pool to be able to mitigate, you know, the sufferings of such people. But the time has come when Nigeria has to look inward and solve its problems. We must prepare ourselves to play on the global stage because the world has become a global village. And as a result, I am 100% in agreement with Mr. President that we should shut down our borders, maybe what you may call, you know, guided deregulation, so that it's not a total blanket. When we do that, we will be able to start to grow certain things in this country, projecting forward. And please, I may not have the opportunity to say something again, but let me say this. The hate speech bill is going to be one of the worst things to happen to this country. I was privileged to attend a very, very high-level, confidential, I would say, strategy meeting with the chairman of the Senate Committee on Anti-Corruption and Financial Crimes. And the essence was, to what extent do we network a policy and strategy that gives the anti-corruption fight a national buy-in and all those things. And one of such things that came out was creation of a national eye, which allows every Nigerian to be a part of the crusade, you know? And I believe, I hope that the National Assembly gives this chairman that opportunity to bring this, which is going to be a revolution on our anti-corruption fight. And you are not going to do that by making people afraid by way of the so-called regulation of the social media. Unfortunately, I cannot go into details of this, but I believe that I can see light at the end of the tunnel, and we must be careful on what legislations we bring out, whether it's going to scare Nigerians or it's going to encourage Nigerians. For every law, there are the pros and the cons. There are the consequences. There are things that you've got to lose to be able to gain. And I think that this is one law that is going to do us more harm than good. There's too much secrecy in government. There's too much. Very soon, you won't be able to see a video of your governor collecting, you know, a bribe and putting his agbada, because if you ever dare to put that up, you are probably going to be hanged. Meanwhile, the people that are stealing millions and billions, that are taking advantage of the vulnerability and the ignorance of the people, are going scot-free. And you are going to hang a man who is this bill targeting? It's not Ms. Audofia in the village. It's not him. It's the big man that must be protected. That big man should be exposed, should be vulnerable, so that he'll be careful and knowing that everybody's watching, and that action he takes might just be showing up in the social media in no time.
Mr. Aitok, as we wind down our closing moments, so we'll just start off with you. Weigh in on the culture, mindset, and thinking in 1 minute.
The mind of a man is the most powerful thing. That's why the Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. I pray that the most important institution in this country is revisited. That most important institution is not Ministry of Finance, is not Ministry of Petroleum, is not Ministry of Works. It is the National Orientation Agency. The day we catch the vision of the essence of this agency, things will start to change.
Stone, what do you
I'm happy about what Ezekiel said, but you should have reminded him that I made this statement 2015 when this administration was sworn in. Exactly the same thing. I said it 2015. I said the most important appointment because they need to cement the cracks that were created during the very horrible election period. I said a national orientation agency to calm down this country, let's walk as one. It was ignored. Today it's been said in 2019. We're going to say it in 2023 until disintegration. Thank you.
Mass reorientation is what we need. I quickly refer to when we had Ebola. The orientation, the market women, the children in the school, every person, almost every Nigerian was aware of what Ebola was all about. The same thing. And there's almost every Nigerian, including those that dropped out from school, went through primary school. We should introduce teachings or subjects that will help reorientate the mindset from that level. That's my take.
As we say, Pong
Kwem.
Kwem. Thank you. We've been speaking with Mr. Onscar Onwudiwe, who is a legal practitioner. We had Tony Daniel also here in our legal studio, also a legal practitioner. And from our Abuja studio, we have architect Ezekiel Nyaeto, who's the Director General of the Nigeria First Project. Thank you, gentlemen, for sharing your thoughts with us.
Thank you very much.
Sunrise will be back in a moment. Please stay with us.